And the Radio 1 transmitters are now closing down until 5 o'clock tomorrow morning, when we'll be joining Radio 2 until 7 o'clock. Then DLT will be along with the breakfast show. Ah, Radio 3, eh? Of course, this is real broadcasting, you know. You can tell by the potted plants in the studio. Mind you, Radio 2 is a quite different kettle of fish. Homespun fun and Lord Carrington over 11s. But I bet they don't get 50 demo tapes a day to listen to. Ah, all my music-loving colleagues. I've been on Radio 1 for 13 years now, you know. These are just kids. Spotty upstarts.
Come here to investigate the state of rock music today. Is the party over? Are the pina coladas drying up in Palm Springs? Will the tequila sunrises finally set over Sunset Boulevard? Is this another television rock documentary where someone's sent out to somewhere exotic to talk to a group based in Carshalton Beeches? Well, I'm afraid not. This is Carshalton Beeches. And you see, the record industry would have us believe that it's on its deathbed at the moment, and yet, as producer of John Peel's Radio 1 rock programme, I can assure you that we find that, particularly since the punk revolution of 1976, there's in fact more music about than there ever was before. Sure, the record companies say, where's the new Elton John? Where's the new Rod Stewart? Well, not round here, I'm glad to say, slamming the car doors and keeping us up to all hours with the goings-on. But behind the lace curtains of these desirable commuter properties, young musicians do meet, as they do in your area, and they record and rehearse. And here at number 37, we have Move to India, a real suburban supergroup made of two local groups, Clinical Red and the Eiger Beat. So although they may feel chills in Beverly Hills, they don't in Brambledown Road. So, this is the Carshalton Beeches sound, is it? This group was made of two bands originally, Clinical Red and Eiger Beat. Can you put your hands up? Who was actually in Clinical Red originally?
Was.
So, Pete, you were the drummer in Clinical Red. Yeah. Well, what's happened to the drummer in Eiger Beat then?
He's in this band as well.
And which is the drummer in Eiger?
Drummer in Eiger Beat.
Oh, so Keith was in Eiger Beat. Yeah. And Pete's, but do you sometimes play drums in?
I play drums as well, yes.
In it? So how many others of you play more than one instrument in the band?
Everybody.
So you all vary on something, so it's never the same band twice a lot of the time, isn't it? So, out of curiosity, how often do you play? What, a couple of times a week?
Once a week. Sometimes twice a week.
No. What, proper gigs, like?
No, just in here.
Oh, so your main venue is actually in this room?
Yeah.
Oh, Keith, this is your house, of course, isn't it?
This used to be my bedroom.
This used to be the bedroom. What's all this business on those ceilings and on the walls?
Well, it's an attempt at soundproofing the place.
Oh, I see. It's all egg boxes, is it? I mean, did you get any complaints from the neighbours?
No, we don't. Surprisingly enough.
You have got some neighbours. But what other bands are there around here, then?
Well, there's a band called The Skeptics. They sort of live round the corner, sort of up the road. And
there's a band called The Icon, another band who use this as a rehearsal room, who I think they're called Tango Ward or something, but I don't think they really know what they're called.
So do you mean they come here as well?
Yeah, they come here
sometimes,
sort of,
yeah.
Occasionally, you know.
A band called Polka Style as well.
Where do you think it's going to go from here? I mean, what is your next step? Are you happy playing in a bedroom in Carshalton?
Well, it's sort of, you know, gigs around here, Croydon, you know, pub gigs, I don't know.
But if you've got the opportunity to pack up whatever your work is or whatever your normal life is and actually work regularly playing for a few months or a year, would you take it?
Yeah.
So what do you see coming out of this? And do you really feel, well, what I want to be in life is Rod Stewart?
No, it's not that. It's just I enjoy it. I enjoy this morning going to work.
Once the voice of the flower power generation, John Peel now provides a unique platform for the thousands of groups formed in the wake of punk rock. In 1976, while all the pundits threw up their hands in horror, Peel was the only DJ to realise punk's significance.
Generally speaking, it all got a bit predictable by the mid-70s. And it's one of those things where you don't realise, it's like you're banging your head against the wall, you don't realise how good it is when you stop, until you stop, you know. And it wasn't until the punk thing started that, I mean, I assumed that all of my audience were going to go along with me, you know. I thought they'd be really pleased that there was been a bit of a change, but of course they weren't, you know. And we had lost a lot of listeners at that stage, and then picked up more subsequently.
Well, it obviously became far more exciting at that time. And for once, I mean, I really thought, well, I don't know about him, but I thought, well, I'm approaching middle age now. Because I remember in, I think, 76 or 77, I went to see Genesis, and after the first 20 seconds or so, I thought, oh, God, I wish this had stopped. And you knew it was going to go on for 40 minutes. But then when we went to see that Clash concert with the Prefects opening, who are now the Nightingales, they stood and they did an 8-second number for a starter.
Yeah, they just came on. The first says, I can't do his accent, but he just came on. So this is our first song.
The Prefects from Birmingham.
Our first song's called I've Got VD. And he just goes, I've Got VD! And for our second number, we'd like to...
And I thought, this is great. You know, yeah, I'll be able to get home in time to see some television, you know. So that was an advantage for a start.
Because I take it much... I mean, it's not much more serious, but I get much more emotional about things. I mean, I remember going to see Emerson, Lake and Parker when they did their
first... He's cried at concerts.
I
cried at Emerson, Lake
and Parker. And it was at the Albert Hall, not the Albert Hall, the Festival Hall. Sure. And some twerp, you know, real sort of colour supplementary twerp came whizzing back and shouting to some friends who were sitting next to me. He said, oh, blown! My mind's absolutely blown! Like this, and I thought, and I was in tears, you know, because I thought, it's all gone terribly, terribly wrong, all this pompous, overblown, arrogant nonsense, you know. And I was really upset about it.
Sure.
Now, as Walters is about to demonstrate to you, you've got this ludicrous, I mean, very welcome proliferation. I mean, this is... I won't say this is one day's supply of tapes, but...
See, and also, it's a lot easier to actually not only form a band. You don't have to start by buying a smoke machine, as I'm sure people thought after seeing Genesis and Yes in the early 70s. Now, also, you can tape at home. Everybody seems to have a home tape recorder.
Yeah.
Not only do they have one, they have a group, they make a tape, and they send it to us.
So when it first started, was it...
Dear John, we are the Sex Pistols.
No.
And in tonight's programme, we're going to be hearing from the Liggers, five lovable mop tops from Manchester, the Skids, the toast of Dunfermline, international megastars, and canny footballers. They've come a long way since their first London gig in a Stoke Newington pub. Plus, particular favourites of mine, and for those of you who remember the Prefects with affection, the Nightingales, who I went to see recently at the Colourful Star Social Club in Birmingham.
Oh,
say who the prefects were.
Us three, Duffy, a bloke called Ted and a bloke called Alan.
Why did you change from the prefects to the Nightingales?
Well, the prefects split up ages ago. It's old tapes. The prefects split up because we'd been going for 2.5 years.
Who did these posters and things?
This one for Vindaloo was done by the Janet and Johns. That's sort of plugging their record on the one side and just tells a bit about the label on the one side. These other things, which are assorted posters for gigs, were done either by me or Joe. They're just for Nightingales things.
What's your idea of what should a poster look like, do you think?
I don't know. I'm not a poster designer, really. The only thing why we do these is because if you're playing a gig and no one knows about it, no one comes. So on a poster such as this, we write the names of the groups that are playing, where it's taking place, the time and the price. We don't have any flashy designs because if a poster looks really clever, people take them home. And so their advertising purposes are failed. This one's quite flash, you know, a few Nightingales there. And we've got a bit of a space monster on this. And on these, our early designs, we use this, the character of Pop from Pop, Dick and Harry and the Topper, as our sort of father figure. And this one's of the band. We've got different haircuts now.
Have you had any artistic training, any of you?
Not a sod.
I've been kept inside against my will. 12 years of my life because the lingerie me. Defensive watching, lost enough. In the bottom of work of time, people left naked. Very electric for standing up, I'm in. Very electric for standing up. Very electric for standing up, I'm in. Very electric for standing up.
I think one thing that we're doing now is that the musician aspect has been swept away, really, because it's not relevant. You know, it's almost like, is it, everybody used to say Picasso, sort of, well, because he gets two eyes on the wrong side, but of course he can really draw properly.
Yeah.
But I think we're now providing room for things like drummers who've got no sense of rhythm. You know, that isn't actually a joke. It's not impossible for someone who can't play to want to do some sort of musical thing.
And how can you explain how someone who can't play technically could have something worth listening.
No, I can't.
No, you just can't explain it. You listen to it and you think it
sounds right or it doesn't sound right, you know.
It's really rather like in the 50s, in my youth, when skiffle started, and you didn't have to suddenly join a big band and get stacks of Brill Cream and buy a saxophone and have 5 years lessons before you could play popular music. You just bought a dustbin bass or a guitar and you played it at home.
I was talking to some lad, came up and he said, oh yeah, you've been in such and such a band. And I said, oh yeah, we played your record. What are you doing now? He said, well, we broke up, you know. I can't remember, I wish I could remember the name of the back on who it was now, but so we broke up. So why'd you do that? He said, well, we'd made the record, it'd been played on the radio, and that was as far as we wanted to go. You know, and I think that's really a healthy attitude.
We've had a lot of people come in the office and say, thanks for playing our record. You say, oh, you've done well. Yes, we sold 1,000 and we might print another. So it's not the big business thing. It really is almost like a folk industry. They're doing it at home.